Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center podcast. We hope that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a word from Pastor Jim Cobray.
I'm going to get down on my knees. Come on, stand on your feet. Let's go before the Lord. Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor. Thank you, Lord, for a mighty move of your Spirit in our hearts, our lives, this day as we come before you in Jesus' mighty name. We're grateful people, Father, that we can come fully expecting the teacher of the church, not a man, not a woman, you know, but the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us and motivate us to be all that you would have us to be. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. We thank you, Father, for the great moves of God in all the churches all around the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet. Everybody that's preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, we just bless them, Lord, as you would bless us this day, night. We just thank you, God, for them and ask you to touch them, heal them, strengthen them in Jesus' mighty name. With a great big shout, we all say amen. Well, this is a marriage series. Listen, a lot of times people get confused. Last week with Harry and Cheryl, man, that was really, really good. I really enjoyed those two. And I didn't know they were going to be that candid with you. I mean, they were like blunt, weren't they? I mean, it was like, oh my goodness. I only thought Debbie and I felt that way at times about each other. And it was good to hear that somebody else hated the other. No, it is. And so they were really good, and I really enjoyed that. This week, you know, I have three more messages, and including tonight's, which is two more after tonight. Deborah has another one, so it's at least four more weeks every Sunday night about marriage. And the reason for that is because we're doggone it, we're just not going to be in a hurry. We're just not going to get to the place where we're rushing through things. You know, the Word of God defines everything. I mean, if you want to know how to do life and which way to do it, the purpose of why you're here, how to be successful in your job or your children, how to be successful with your relatives and friends, how to be fulfilled at the end of your life. You know, at the end of my life, I could tell you one thing, God is faithful. All the years of serving God, preaching the gospel, I can tell you all the tough times that we go through, all of us do. I could tell you that God, at the end of my life, I'm making this statement, God is faithful. And he's never let me down. He's come through. Deborah and I were talking about it today. I remember a time when we were just kids. I think I was about 32 or 33, and Deborah was in her late 20s, probably the same age as the young man that just stood up. We were broke. We didn't know what to do. We said, God, we don't know what to do. We don't know how to pay our bills. We've been working hard. There wasn't any money. Another recession back in the 80s, early 80s, had interest rates 21%. You just couldn't get anywhere. Just life looked like it was failing. And we'll never forget, we're building this project. And I may have told you this story before, but the project, in order to get financing on this project, had about 25 houses in it. And in order to get financing, every house had to be pre-sold before they would, you know, they had to have a list. And pre-sold meant just that somebody was on the list wanting to buy that particular house. Well, it came to one house. I think it was lot 14. Debbie remembers it as a different lot, lot 20 something. But I think it was lot 14. And it was the only one no one wanted. So I put my name on there. I said, I'll buy it. And we're going to go to the bank with it, you know. And I'll never forget this as long as I live. A man in Lake Arrowhead drove up in an old beat up car and came into the office and he said, I want to talk to somebody. You have a list, I hear, of people that are waiting to buy those houses you're going to build. I said, I do. And he says, I don't want any house. There's a specific house I want. And I want to pay you for it. Up front, I want whoever's on there and whoever's name is on there, I want you to get their name off and put my name on there. And I'll give those people $5,000 if we could just move their name off, put my name on. So which house do you like? And he says, number 14. I said, well, I happen to be on number 14. He said, that's fine. He said, take your name off, And this is how it was done. I literally got an eraser, penciled my name in, and I penciled my name off. He gave me his name. I have no idea. Don't even remember it. And he handed me a check, printed the name, and he handed me a cashier's check for $5,000. Guys, that was like 100 years ago. $5,000 is like, you know, $50,000 today. And did you know that I never heard from that man ever again? Got in his old beat up car, smoke piling out of it, drove up the street. We both looked at each other, had a $5,000 check. We said, do you think that's real? Let's go to the bank. Bank says, absolutely, got $5,000, paid our bills. Can I tell you something? That was an angel. Never heard. Who gives you $5,000? Who would come up to you and give you $50,000 cashier's check? Listen to one of my words. Give you a $50,000 cashier's check today and then never see him again. Who would do that? Nobody. I'm telling you, it was an angel. And I had an angel encounter. We were talking about it just today. We were up at Lake Arrowhead for lunch and we just reminisced about old things, you know, the snow and our children being born there and living there and pastoring. Talk about pastoring in a difficult place, that was tough. You know, it was a vacation area and nobody wanted to come to church on weekends. And they just wanted to work, make money because everybody comes up on weekends. And I'm trying to get everybody to church. And it was just tough times. And that angel of the Lord showed up, gave us $5,000. We paid our bills for probably the next 5 months, 4 months. That's what it cost to live in those days, probably 4 or 5 months worth of income in those days. I'm telling you, when you serve God, let me say it again. When you serve God, that means you don't just come and daydream. You don't come just put your time in. But you really have a heart for God. When you really have a heart for God and to follow His ways, I promise you God will meet your needs over and above your imagination, even above what you could possibly think or expect. God is greater. He's a faithful, wonderful God. Tonight, as we approach the word of the Lord about marriage, I'm going to read to you once again out of Ephesians, the 5th chapter. I think this is really fascinating. And I'm just going to kind of briefly go through it. Don't forget, if you came, you got a card, you should fill it out, put your name on it, drop it in one of the prayer boxes outside. Because in the next 3 or 4 weeks, we're going to have a drawing of somebody who's going to get a weekend vacation or 2 nights and expenses paid at a Pacific Palms Hotel in Los Angeles, which is beautiful. And it's all paid for by us because we love you so much. We want you to get involved. But you ought to be able to fill out that and drop it in there. If you want more information, you can talk to somebody about it outside. There'll be somebody there to talk to you about it. Ephesians 5th chapter, verse 21. Submitting one to another in the fear of the Lord. Everything you do is because you fear God. Fearing God doesn't mean you're afraid necessarily, but fearing God means you have this deep, awesome respect for God. Buried an old friend of ours yesterday. One of the great things about him is, you know, the whole family said all kinds of things about him. He was this, he was that. They all kind of laughed, and it was kind of like a little undertow of a joke. It really made me quite angry, to be honest with you. This man was a man who feared God. That makes him really smart. God's looking for a people who will simply submit one to another because not because they're good to you or that's the thing to do, but because God says to do it. Verse number 22 comes along. It says, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. Deborah talked about that. For the husband is the head of the wife. And husbands, we need to be leading them in the ways of the Lord. As also Christ is the head of the church and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and the church gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of the water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot nor wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Wow, God has a job to do to clean us up, is what he's saying. And God wants to clean us up. And just like the husband's responsibility is to make sure his family is cleansed and ready for God. I don't know when God's coming. You don't know when God's coming. Could be very much tonight. Could happen tonight. The eastern sky splits. Jesus comes. And you want to be ready. You don't want to be someone who just says, well, I'm going to try to get ready. Remember the virgins, the 10 virgins, 5 had oil, 5 had none. And they're out there trying to get a hold of the oil. Here's the reason why. Because they weren't really ready. They knew he was coming, but they weren't ready. You and I are working to a place we need to be ready. When he comes, and whenever that is, we need to be that person that's going to be presented properly to the Lord. He goes on and he says this, verse number 28. So husbands ought to love their wives as their own, love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. No one ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourished it, cherished it, just as the Lord does the church. For we are members of his body and of his flesh and of his bone. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is going to be in the future. We're going to talk about that. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. In other words, he's given an example of Christ and the church, verse number 33. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she, and I love this word, respects her husband. We talked about a lot of areas, but the one area that I wanted to share with you that God has impressed upon me today to share with you about marriage is this. Notice this out of, if you will, Ephesians verse number 29. For no one ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourished it. Remember, we talked about the importance of nourishment last time we were together. But the husband has a responsibility to make sure that his family is nourished. Not just talk about paying the bills, not just talk about proper food, but talk about spiritual relationships. We talked about the great depth of how to nourish that family. But I thought it was really interesting because he doesn't stop with the word nourish. Here comes another commandment to the husbands, and notice what he says. He says, and cherishes it. No one yet ever, he says this, no one ever yet hated his own flesh. But what does he do to his own flesh? Because remember, your wife and you are one as one flesh. But nourishes it and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. A lot of times we see the word cherish, we just kind of like blow through it. We don't think it as much, but here's God saying something really deep for all of us in that one word, cherish. A lot of times we don't think about what it's like to cherish, but can I just give you a simple illustration of cherish so that you can remember this? Cherish means this, and it's so simple and so wonderful. It really means to take somebody or something and place a value on them. A lot of times we don't value the people that we relate with. And it's really quite a simple process, but it's something that we overlook oftentimes. Sometimes we take it for granted. Sometimes we don't really work at placing a value on someone. We treat them as if they have no value whatsoever. But I know this, that if you had something in your life that was valuable, you would protect it. Oftentimes you'll see a man, his car is so valuable, he'll out there polishing his car all the time, spend more time on that car and getting it without one spot of dust. So when he drives down the street, that which is valuable to him will be seen as something very important to him. You'll see oftentimes with ladies with jewelry being very valuable, maybe rings or something to that effect. And you don't take them and just throw them around. You put them in a very secure place and you wear them only in places that you're going to be protected in because you are protecting the value of something. You have established a value on some things. And many times we establish values in areas of our life. Our job has values. Our neighbors have value. What people think of us has value. But we don't ever place a value on the one that is the closest to us, so that we can start treating them in such a way as if they are a valuable commodity that God's placed in our life. And until we do, we're never going to be proper with our wives as God would have us to do it. So tonight, I just wanted to share some things about value, on how to establish value. Just simple two things. How to establish value. Because anything that I cherish, I see as valuable. So how is it that God would have me to establish in my walk anything of value? If you take this and place it on your husband, you can take this and place it on your walk with God. You can place it on your God. You can place it and put it anywhere in your life. Anything that you want to establish as valuable is going to determine where your emphasis is going to be at. Because if you don't see it as valuable, you'll treat it as common. And it's very important how to establish. Number one, I want to share this with you. Stop devaluing. There's a devaluation that takes place with our mouths. Sometimes what we do is we devalue something by what we think about it. We allow our mouths to speak what we feel, what we see, instead of the truth. Did you know that in order for your heart to properly maintain a value of something, your heart must be trained to value it? But if you're constantly bombarding your heart with negative thoughts, if you're constantly bombarding your heart with criticism and judgments and speaking things of failure over your partner, you will never do anything but devalue them, and nowhere and no time will you ever be in a place of placing a value that you need to on them in order to protect them and see them as one and as important in your life. Too many people are married and don't see the value of their partner. And oftentimes they get angry with the way the partner acts or the way the partner talks or the way the partner does things or the way the partner cooks or cleans or does things different than you might think. And all of a sudden, in your mind, you're simply stating something oftentimes that it usually comes out of your mouth somewhere, and you're literally doing something. You're very much poisoning your value system. And when you pour poison on your value system, which is your heart, because your heart's the only one that can establish the value of something. The heart doesn't know anything. I've told you this many times before. Your brain tells your heart how to feel. And the words that you hear, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And when you speak something contrary to the word of God, your heart just hears it, and all of a sudden you're heavy about it, or you don't like it. And there's no way you'll ever continue placing a value on somebody that you've poisoned the well over. And all of us are in here, we've been married long enough to know that there's things we can do and things we can't do. One thing we can't do, we cannot poison the well of our value system, our hearts. We can't keep speaking negative things and devaluating that which God says we're to treat as valuable and expect to have a great relationship. It just doesn't work that way. Doesn't matter how many times they fail. Doesn't matter how many times they make mistakes. It doesn't matter how many times they goof up or screw up in something or do something different than what you think it ought to be done. Are they valuable or not valuable? And what you speak out of your mouth, your heart will hear, and eventually that's what you will feel about them. Instead of being placed a value on them, you will be devaluating them all the time. I mean, the Bible makes it very clear that as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Oh my goodness. And if my heart is telling me something different than what I'm supposed to be doing, how did my heart get there? Except I was thinking and hearing, I was speaking to myself words that were contrary to what God says. And without it, man, I'm telling you the truth, we're going to fail. There will never be a value. We'll be disvaluing people. We'll criticize. We'll judge them. We'll put them down. It won't be very long before you're out of love and you don't have anything. That's why I always say, if you ever have a problem about somebody, start praying for them. You won't have a problem with them after a while. Because you know why? Your heart starts to hear your prayers for somebody, and all of a sudden your heart says, wow, I really want them to be successful. You just trained your heart to get out of devaluating somebody. And it's so important for us to see. James says it like this in the 3rd chapter. Have you got your Bibles tonight? Come into the Rock Church. You ought to always have your Bibles. Even though we put it up on the overhead, there are new people that are new and don't know to bring their Bibles. You that are not new, been around for a while, you ought to have a Bible every time you walk across the parking lot. James, the third chapter, it says in verse number 8, it says this, but no man can tame his tongue. Really talking about the words of our mouth. The words of our mouth are vitally important because they train your heart on how to feel. And they place a value on stuff or take the value off of stuff all by the words of your mouth. And he says, no man can tame his the tongue. It's an unruly evil full of deadly poison. The whole point, that reason it's saying that, is because only the Holy Spirit and the power of the Holy Spirit on the inside of us can control our tongue. You can't do it yourself as a man, but I can do it because God gives me the power of the Holy Spirit to do it. I can control what I think. I can control what I say. And instead of, you know, have you ever gotten to the place where you get uglier and uglier about somebody? You just think worse and worse and worse. Days go by and all of a sudden, life is horrible. Let me tell you something. You don't have to do that. You can stop immediately. Train yourself that immediately when you start to think something ugly and start to say something ugly about somebody, that you stop right there, because what you're going to do is you're going to devalue them, and then all of a sudden your heart's going to be heavy about them. So he says, your tongue is an unruly evil, but only by the power of the Holy Spirit. But it goes on in verse number 9. Listen to what it says in verse number 9. In verse 9, it says this, with it we bless our God and Father, and with it, speaking of the tongue, we curse men who have been made in the similitude or the same image of God. In other words, something's wrong here. What's taking place is where our mouth is speaking from our old nature, what it is we feel or what it is we've allowed our thinking to do. What we need to do is understand that what comes out of your mouth is going to define your future and define the feelings of your heart and whether or not you've placed a value on that person, whether it's male or female, husband or wife. But we're talking about this. It works both ways. You cannot speak garbage out of your mouth and expect blessings back. Doesn't work. Notice what it says, verse number 10. Now the same mouth proclaims blessings and cursing. My brethren, these ought not to be so. In other words, it makes it very clear that you can't speak something contrary to the ways of God about your spouse and then expect your spouse to be a blessing to you. It doesn't work that way. Verse number 11 comes on. Does a spring send forth fresh water and bitter from the same opening? Can a fig tree, verse number 12, my brethren, bear olives? Or a grapevine bear figs? Thus no spring yield both salt water and fresh. Springs don't bring forth both. Your heart is trained by what comes out of your mouth. What comes out of your mouth is what you've been thinking. And therefore, when you're thinking something evil and wrong, even if they acted evil and wrong, don't go there. Start speaking what God says about them, because what you're doing is you're training your heart to maintain the value of cherishing them forever, even during their difficult times. Is anybody listening? The number one thing on how, and it's so important for us, is how to establish value, is you've got to stop devaluing. I can't tell you how many people devalue everything. They devalue the Word of God. They devalue the church. They devalue their friends. They devalue their boss. They devalue everything. They're always speaking something out of their mouth that's poisoning the well of life that trains the heart to establish the value. Listen to this. Without a value system, you will never have a faithful system. How can I ever be faithful to something I don't see as valuable? Let's take it in lines with God for an example. How can I ever be faithful to God if I've been devaluing God? If I don't think He is what He is, I don't think He cares about me. I'm really not made in His image. I really don't know that He loves me. I really don't care about worshiping God. In other words, my value system is very bad with God. And therefore, I'm going to be faithful to God. Won't happen. I'll be faithful to God as long as it's convenient to me. And as soon as the pressure comes, I'll be gone. And your value systems establish your faithfulness. Let me say it again. Your value systems establish your faithfulness. And if your value system has been polluted because of the words that come out of your mouth and your thinking, because as a man thinks in his heart, so is he, then it won't be very long before you're out of there. And that's what happens in Americans today. Marriages. It's all about value system. You know what the difference between one person who serves God and is great in their relationship with God and another person who serves God as mediocre in their relationship with God? Value system. On one person having a great value, another person has just a little bit of value, not much. We're talking about how to establish value systems. Number one is you need to stop devaluing. Number two, you need to take a godly appraisal. Now, a lot of times we don't understand what that means. Everything that has value because somewhere along the line, someone appraised it. But have you ever, Antique Roadshow, have you ever watched that? Well, you can hardly wait to see the next series because we're all, well, at least if you're over 40. We love it because everybody brings their antiques in and we're all looking at, oh, what's the value of it? What's the value? They pop up and I go, oh my goodness, I didn't know. I bought it for 25 cents. And so what made it worth so much money? Somebody appraised it. The value of everything, your car, the paintings in your house, the furniture's in your house itself has an appraisal. Your work, someone's appraising your work, ethics. And the appraisal that you put on your spouse or your marriage determines the value system. Now, everybody else gets their appraisal. They gather data. They come to a conclusion economically and come up with a figure. You can't do that with your wife or your husband. The only thing you can do is you have the ability to appraise, and your heart doesn't know what you appraise. It only believes what you tell it. And the appraisal you have for your wife or your husband will establish the value of your wife or your husband. Now watch this. And the value of them will determine how much you will give in your faithful actions back to them, which brings the marriage back together. See, the smartest men in the world are not smart because of the degrees that they have, are not smart because of the education that they have obtained. You can be as dumb as a sack of rocks, know how to read and take tests and get all the degrees you could possibly imagine. The smartest men in the world are not people, listen to this, who have accumulated material things or been successful in their business. That's not what's smart and intelligent. The smartest people in the world are the people who have established a value system based on the appraisal of what life is all about. And life is all about your relationship with God. And when you and I come to a place where we start establishing a value system based on somebody's performance instead of what God says, then we are no different than an appraiser coming through and looking at our house and saying it's devalued by a lot. And it may be off the wall completely, but that's not the real value of something. The real value of your wife or your spouse is what God says about them. And the real appraisal you and I have got to have is not the way they act, not the way they look, not the way they talk, not the way they do, but what God says. And that's the difference between successful, is their appraisal of what's valuable in life. And every one of us can determine for ourselves by appraising what it is that's valuable in our life. The man that we buried yesterday, for an example, he was a truck driver, but he was one of the smartest people I know. And his family just stood and stared at me when I said that. He never made a lot of money. He didn't have an education. He drove a truck. He was part of the union. Yeah. But his appraisal system on what was life about was based on God. And where other people who have money and have all the stuff fail to determine properly the correct values in life, this man didn't. He was one of the smartest men on the planet. And that's what makes you different. And that's what makes it a level playing field for everybody. Is whether or not you have the ability to establish the appraisal that's correctly about life in order to establish the values of life and follow them. Take that now, put it in your spouse. And now you've come out of the word cherish. Because I cherish because of the value system I place on my wife. I cherish most valuable commodity in my life outside of Jesus Christ. Even at times when I'm angry about something or frustrated about something, I can't let my life go there. I've got to make sure my heart is always establishing the correct value. And then I get back in line with what's valuable. It won't be very long before everything gets lined up. Is anybody listening? Very important for us to see. The word worthy is a neat word in the Bible. The word worthy is a word, if you will, that says the value system has been established. And now that you are worthy. Someone who is not worthy is somebody who has no real value. Someone who has real value is truly someone who's worthy. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is judged as worthy, and along with his value, worthy, comes some characteristics of things that show our appraisal of things that makes him valuable. Let's take a look. Fifth chapter of Revelation, verse number 12. Fifth chapter of Revelation, verse 12, saying with a loud voice, sudden, at verse 12, we're talking about a ton of angels here speaking this about Jesus. But I want you to hear the words saying it with a loud voice. It wasn't just a whisper. It wasn't just something written. It wasn't just something thought about. They were now speaking it out loud about Jesus. And they make this statement about Jesus. And may I say this to you? If you can make this statement about Jesus, it ought to be the same way about your spouse. Now watch this. Worthy or valuable is the Lamb who was slain to do something. Watch this. To receive. Slain to receive. I don't know if you got that. Worthy or valuable is the Lamb because he was slain to receive. Power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. In other words, the value of Jesus, we don't have a problem with those seven things that are being presented to us. But if we took those seven characteristics of what is valuable and we placed them on our family, our children, our job, or even our relationship with God, it would change the whole world that you and I live in. For an example, let me give you an illustration. Worthy is a Lamb who was slain to receive power. If I thought about it in terms of my wife, what kind of power does this one that I'm supposed to cherish have? Well, let me tell you. Power to move me one way or the other. And men, somebody needs to tell you. They can move you one way or the other. And that characteristic goes all the way back to Adam and Eve. When she's frustrated about something, I find myself frustrated about something. When she's discouraged about something, I find myself discouraged. When she's in faith about something, I'm in faith about something. She has literally the power to move me one way or the other. Most women do. And we men don't want to believe that, but it's very true. It's described as the neck that turns the head. But it's yet the power of God. The second thing we see about Jesus, which is characteristic, if you will, of the appraisal of the value of Jesus, I love this, is riches. And can I just say this? When Jesus gave me my Deborah, all of a sudden, my life was enriched with purpose. Had no purpose, had no destiny, had no place to go. The appraisal was different. Now with Deborah in my life, I have purpose. And she literally fuses my life together with riches of life. The third thing we see about Jesus we ought to equate also with people of value is the word wisdom. Wisdom to bring me to a side of life that I really don't see. I don't know about you guys, if you'll admit it or not, but oftentimes there's a lot of things I just don't get. I don't see it that way. Doesn't make me right, I'm usually wrong. But somehow Deborah can bring the wisdom of God in and reveal a side of something that I never saw before. I'm telling you, I would paint a house black and white, brown and beige, and that would be it. She'll bring colors in that pop all over the place and moldings in and make that which was just a common house an unusual place. This church, for an example, would have been gray. Have you ever seen churches that are gray all the time? They got some black in there and light different color gray. It's like the ugliest churches in the world. This place is full of life. Because here we find wisdom comes, and this wisdom brings us to a side of life that we don't even see. And in my appraisal, I need to recognize that value of that woman. Fourth thing is strength. Support I need to face the future. God, I'm so full of hope. Lord, I'm so full of life. Lord, I believe such great things. I don't care what my bones say or my joints say or my muscles say. I don't care what, you know, my face looks like or how my hairline isn't there and there's 18 hairs that I'm combing over and around. That doesn't mean anything to me, Lord. What's important is what you can do with me. And as I face the future, I need somebody on my side with strength to support what I need. In order to get where I believe God wants to take us. That's called appraisal, my friend. We don't have a problem with Jesus, but we do have a problem with the ones we're married to. The fifth one is honor. Brings the deepest of respect so my faith stays strong. I need somebody to think good of me. There's too many people in the world that don't like me. Too many people that want to stop me. The devil hates my guts and hates yours too, in case someone never told you this. Do anything and everything to stop you from doing and being anything in life, never allowing you to ever accomplish anything. He'll stop you. He'll discourage you. He'll tell you you can't make it over and over and over and over until your heart really has a place to value on it that says, I can't make it, and then he's won. And I'm here to tell you, honor comes along when a woman respects her man. And I need that respect. I need that honor so that I can face the morrow. And brings the deepest respect. It strengthens my faith. It helps me to keep on going. The sixth one about Jesus that we see in our appraisal we have no problem with is this one called glory. that my wife manifests the goodness of God. I've often said it many times, if it wasn't for my wife, I wouldn't be in ministry. Because it was her that made this statement. Let's do something valuable with our lives. I said, like what? And we tried to go in the mission fields. You know what I'm like in the mission fields? It just didn't work. I don't eat those kind of things. I don't sleep in those kind of beds. What is that crawling around in my soup? I gotta go to the bathroom. I need to be private. I remember being in the mission fields in Africa one time, and I was in the deepest part of Nigeria, Africa. I don't know that they'd ever seen a white man in this place. And I had to go to the bathroom so bad it was unbelievable. I said, stop the car, I don't care. They said, there's a hole over there. I said, what's a hole? That's where you go to the bathroom. I went over to the hole and the flies looked like bumblebees. There was a kid's school next door. Someone yelled, the white man's going to the bathroom. The whole school came out to watch me go to the bathroom. I am not made for the mission field. I remember walking away that day saying, they'll never see me again, so who cares? And they haven't. Oh, but we got a great missions program, and one of the reasons why we have a great missions program is because I ain't going. I'm going to send somebody else and help them, but I'm not going. Somebody know what I'm talking about? The goodness of God manifested. That's what glory is all about. That's what she brings in my life. And also, when you're appraising with a godly appraisal, blessings, the power to succeed, helps me with the power to succeed. Instead of tearing me down, building me up. Instead of saying we can't, says we can. All things are possible to him that believes. And all of a sudden, the value system is now appraised on a godly basis. And when I have the proper appraisal, the value is there. And when the value is there, here comes the cherishing. The protection, the deliverance, the watching over, the making sure that they're okay. Tonight I just wanted to share the word cherish with you. By a godly appraisal, we come to a godly value. And when there's a godly value, there's a godly marriage. That's what all of us need to have. And it starts by what you say and think in your mouth and in your thinking. If God spoke to you today, come on, give the Lord a great big praise. Is that all? That's all? I thought it was pretty good. I'm going to let you go in just a moment. I just want to make sure everybody's all right with God. Listen closely. You don't go to heaven because you're nice, or you go to church, or you're good. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that. Your mom or dad told you you're a Christian, so therefore you're Christian. Took you to catechism class, Sunday school, or Sabbath school class. The only way to get to heaven is you, Jesus says, which is his way. And he says, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man goes to the Father except by me. So you can't get there any other way but Jesus' way. Not my way, not your way will get you to heaven. The only way to get to heaven is his way. And he says in John 3rd chapter, you must be born again. Now let me explain what born again means. It means you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. Stop for a moment. I already know you know who Jesus is in your head. You wouldn't be here if you didn't know who Jesus is. You celebrate Christmas, you celebrate Easter, I already know that. You know who Jesus is. But the devil knows who Jesus is and he's not going to heaven. So head knowledge doesn't get you to heaven. You hear me? I know you have it. But that doesn't get you to heaven. It's what you've done with your heart. And to be born again means you got to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. Why you got to give it to him? Because he's not a thief to rob it from you. It's your heart and life. He's not a conniver to talk you out of it. It's your heart and life. He's not a manipulator to talk you out of it. He's your heart and life. And it's your call. He did what he could do. Go to the cross, loved you so much, a beaten bloody mess. Paid the price. Now it's your call, your choice, whether you'll give God all of your heart, whether you'll give God all of your life. Your call, not mine. And you say, well, Pastor Jim, how do I do that? You got to do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, listen to these words. If you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father as mine. But if you deny me before men, I'll deny you. Now, I'm a man. In a moment, I'm going to count through. I'll go like this. One, two, three. And I'll pop my hands and go, bang. And you hear that sound. Bang. Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. And what you're saying by the raising of your hand is, here's what you're saying. I don't want Jesus in my head like most Americans. I want to give him all of my heart, give him all of my life, be born again, headed for heaven, and denying my presence in hell. Wow. That's a cool statement. All you have to do is raise your hand in a moment. You say, wait a minute. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Somebody will see me. People I came with. People behind me will see me. I'll feel funny if I raise my hand. Yep, you will be. You'll feel funny. Get over it. Better to feel funny for a moment in a safe place like this than to be in hell forever and ever and ever and ever. Cares. You care more about what people think instead of what God sees? Come on, no one's that dumb. But the devil's trying to talk you out of putting your hand up right now. When you know you need to do it, do it. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? Speaking to you. If you've never given God all of your heart, come on, be honest with yourself. I'm speaking to you. Get ready to put your hand up. If you're one of those people that are not sure, make sure. Maybe you prayed with Billy Graham one time, or you prayed at a Harvest Crusade. Hey, that's great. But did you follow up with all of your heart and all of your life? Or were you just quoting magical little abracadabra formula called a prayer? God's not stupid that he sits in heaven and says, I heard the right formula, incorporated all the right way, therefore I guess he'll go to heaven. It's not based on some stupid little formula called a prayer. It's based on something more important, your heart. And he watches your life to see whether or not your life following your heart, whether or not you're serious with God. Tonight, some of you need to get right with God by giving God all of your heart and giving God all of your life. You have misappraised him, and now you need to appraise him correctly and place the highest value of your life being Jesus. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together, your call. Sit there and do nothing, but I did my job. Or get your hand up and let's get right with God. I won't embarrass you, but I want to see your hand at least go up for Jesus. And here you are. God brought you here for this. Don't miss this opportunity. Are you ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one. There's two. Thank you. There's three, four, five, six. Thank you. Seven. Thank you. Eight. Back over here. Thank you. There's another one back here. Nine. Thank you. There's 10 right there. God bless you. All 10 of you. Here's what I want you to do. Get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. If you're number 11, 12, 13, you didn't raise your hand, but you can come too. All 10 of you that raised your hand, and I count you, get your stuff, get your friend if you need to, and meet me right here in front. No one leave during this period of time. All 10 of you. Now, if you're number 11, 12, 13, didn't get your hand up, you can come too. You just come right now. Let's stand and welcome them as they come. Come on. 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 Come on.
I surrender.
No weird stuff goes on. See this guy, his name is Joel over here. Pastor Joel is going to pray with you, give you some free stuff. Everybody loves the word free. It's free. and then tell you about what's next. Now you're going to give your heart to God. What does God expect from you? What does he want you to do? He'll tell you about that, okay? Only takes a few moments. Let us help you get strong in Jesus. Let me say it again. Let us help you to get strong in Jesus. We don't want you to go back, fall through the cracks, do the same stuff you used to do. We want you to go on in the victory with God. Is that okay? So make a left turn, people who came with, they'll wait for you, and follow Pastor Joel right over that way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.